stop turning on that September day. Were you in the yard with your wife and children, or working on some stage in L.A.? Did you stand there in shock at the sight of that black smoke rising against that blue sky? Did you shout out in anger and fear for your neighbor, or did you just sit down and cry? Did you weep for the children who lost their dear loved ones, pray for the ones who don't know? Did you rejoice for the people who walked from the rubble and sob for the ones left below? Did you burst out with pride for the red, white, and blue, and the heroes who died just doing what they do? Did you look up to heaven for some kind of answer, and look at yourself and what really matters? I'm just a singer of simple songs. I'm not a real political man. I watch CNN, but I'm not sure I can tell you the difference in Iraq and Iran. But I know Jesus, and I talk to God, and I remember this from when I was young. Faith, hope, and love are some good things He gave us, and the greatest is love. Where were you when the world stopped turning on that September day? Teaching a class full of innocent children, or driving down some cold interstate? Did you feel guilty 'cause you're a survivor? In a crowded room, did you feel alone? Did you call up your mother and tell her you loved her? Did you dust off that Bible at home? Did you open your eyes and hope it never happened? Close your eyes and not go to sleep? Did you notice the sunset first time in ages, speak to some stranger on the street? Did you lay down at night, think of tomorrow, go out and buy you a gun? Did you turn off that violent old movie you're watching and turn on I Love Lucy reruns? Did you go to a church and hold hands with some strangers, stand in line and give your own blood? Did you just stay home and cling tight to your family? Thank God you had somebody to love. I'm just a singer of simple songs. I'm not a real political man. I watch CNN, but I'm not sure I can tell you the difference in Iraq and Iran. But I know Jesus, and I talk to God, and I remember this from when I was young. Faith, hope, and love are some good things He gave us, and the greatest is love. I'm just a singer of simple songs. I'm not a real political man. I watch CNN, but I'm not sure I can tell you difference in Iraq and Iran. But I know Jesus, and I talk to God, and I remember this from when I was young. Faith, hope, and love are some good things He gave us, and the greatest is love. And the greatest is love. And the greatest is love. Where were you when the world stopped turning on that September day?
my heart be changed, renewed, flowing from the grace that I found.
And Lord, I've come to know the weaknesses I see.
Let us focus on God's presence.
In the midst of a world where people hunger and thirst,
come worship a God who feeds the hungry.
In the midst of a world where people are abused and oppressed,
come worship a God who calls for compassion and justice.
In the midst of a world filled with wars and rumors of wars,
come worship a God who desires nothing less than peace for the world. Come worship a God who gives life meaning.
Come, let us worship the Lord, whose grace and love know no end. Let us pray. God, we thank you for this day and this time, in the day where we remember what happened 21 years ago. God, we still remember. We remember the pain and the sorrow. But God, today we also remember how you took that tragedy and turned it into stories of testimony where people have come to know you and your love. God, let us worship you today in this place and always. In your Son's name, amen. Please be seated. Do we have birthdays and anniversaries? I guess you don't have to have both, just one or the other? Ah. Look at you. Okay. 10, 20, help us, 30, 40. She's doing it really fast, 42. She wants to be done, 40, 42. Okay. Now, good for you that you didn't run for the hills. Hang out for just a second and let us sing and celebrate, and then you can run for the hills. Okay. Back to your seat. I remember that people flooded the churches. There was so many people in church for about 3 weeks, and then it went back. It started diminishing. We that's about how long it takes for us to decide that we can go back to normal. Which is sad. So we pray for, I think there's a lot of truth in praying for not what happened on the 11th, but how God brought us together after that, and that we are together again. So we're going to start our prayers with that. God, in your grace and mercy, hear are our prayers. Anyone else? Yeah. So for your aunt, for your uncle, and for the entire family as they grieve, but also a blessing that your niece is Sweet dancing. Kylie. Sorry?
Sweet Kylie Ray.
Sweet Kylie Ray is dancing in heaven. God, in your grace and mercy, hear our prayers. For a reunion, God, in your grace and mercy, hear our prayers. Anyone else?
She'll make it. She'll be fine. But
yeah, absolutely. We do hold Brooke in our prayers, and to everyone who has COVID, that it's, I mean, even if you're not feeling bad, you still probably go stir crazy in the house knowing that you're trying to keep everybody else safe. So when she's out and running around, give her a hug for us.
Okay.
So for Brooke, God, in your grace and mercy, hear our prayers. Wow. Okay. Prayers for harvest and prayers for everyone that is working the harvest everywhere, the harvest in the community. Absolutely. Yeah. And prayers for those that are supporting those that are working in the harvest. Yeah. God, in your grace and mercy, hear our prayers. And we miss you all when you're not here. And we were praying for a smooth traveling gig with you and your sister and your grandma. So yeah, so we are glad you're here. Yeah, God, in your grace and mercy, hear our prayers. Janine.
I enjoy
good friends like you and your husband who were there to try to care for him. So that was a blessing. Yeah, so for good friends and for wise doctors, God, in your grace and mercy, hear our prayers. Anyone else? Anyone else? All right, let us pray. God, we thank you. We thank you for this time and this place to give you all of our prayers, to give you our hearts, to give you what's on our minds, to share with each other. And God, we just know that all we have to do is lift them up to you and you take care of everything. What a blessing. As people remember the tragedy of 21 years ago, let us also remember and reflect on how we were brought to our knees, but then brought to church. Help people return. Return to you, Lord. Let us come together now in a prayer that your Son taught others, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Okay, I need a couple of ushers so that we can continue with our worship of our Lord. So if we can have a couple of them come forward, that would be wonderful. Thank you both. Would you stand as you're able for the doxology?
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
God, we thank you. We thank you for all that you give to us, and then in returning it, you take it and do amazing work. God, bring your people. Help us to be a part of your love and the reflection of Christ's love. In your Son's name, amen. Please be seated.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Probably should have said that earlier. But okay. Today we're reading from 2 Corinthians. Chapter 12, verses 2 to 10. You know that when you were pagans, somehow or other you were influenced and led astray to mute idols. Therefore, I want you to know that no one who is speaking by the Spirit of God says, Jesus be cursed. And no one can say, Jesus is Lord, except by the Holy Spirit. There are different kinds of gifts, but the same Spirit distributes them. There are different kinds of service, but the same Lord. There are different kinds of working, but in all of them and in everyone, it is the same God at work. Now, to each one, the manifestation of the Spirit is given for the common good. To one, there is given through the Spirit a message of wisdom, to another, a message of knowledge by means of the same Spirit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. To another, gifts of healing by that one Spirit. To another, miraculous powers. To another, prophecy. To another, distinguishing between spirits. And another, speaking in different kinds of tongues. And to still another, the interpretation of tongues.
These are the words of our Lord. Praise be to God. So this morning, thank you, Jesse.
You're welcome.
This morning we're talking about telling your story. And telling your story can be really easy. So I don't want it to, intimidate. I don't want it to intimidate you, okay? I want you to just hang out with me and just think about what your story is for God. We've heard and will hear in a few minutes more stories. We've heard stories of 9/11, and I've got a few more for you. And in those stories, what I also want you to hear is that God takes something horrible and ugly and turns it to something where people can spread his word of love and people are brought to God out of tragedy. Whatever your story is, God uses that to talk to people about who he is. So 2 Corinthians 12, 2 through 10, and we're going to read a little bit more about that. It's an unusual piece of scripture if taken out of context. And so I want to read that to you, and then I want you to think about how did we get to this context. So it says, I know a believer in Christ who was taken up to the third heaven 14 years ago. I don't know if his body was taken up or not, only God knows. And I don't know if that man was in his body or out of it, only God knows. But I do know that he was taken up to paradise. He heard things there that could not be put into words. There were things that no one is allowed to talk about. I will brag about a man like that, but I won't brag about myself. I will brag about a man about how weak I am. Suppose I decide to brag. Well, that would not make me a fool because I would be telling the truth. But I don't brag so that no one will think more of me than they should. People should judge me by what I do and say. God has shown me amazing and wonderful things. People should not think more of me because of it. So I would not become proud of myself. I was given a problem. This problem caused pain in my body. It is a messenger from Satan to make me suffer. Three times I asked the Lord to take it from me, but he said to me, my grace is all you need. My power is strongest when you are weak. So I am very happy to brag about how weak I am, and then Christ's power can rest on me. Because of how I suffered for Christ, I am glad that I am weak. I am glad in hard times. I am glad when people say mean things about me, and I am glad when things are difficult. And I am glad when people make me suffer. When I am weak, I am strong. Now, the scripture that Jesse read, as well as this scripture, are both Paul. And Paul is saying that there are a lot of gifts that we have been blessed with, but each gift we should not be bragging about. That's kind of what Jesse was saying. Each gift we should not be bragging about. We should recognize that they are gifts from God in order for us to do his work, and part of our work is to share our stories. Okay? Paul was an amazing storyteller. That was one of his gifts, to be a storyteller. But he didn't brag. He didn't say what an amazing storyteller he was. He was saying, because God works through me, I can do what God has called me to do. So this that I've just read is this unusual piece of scripture if taken out of context. After Paul writes the chapters in 2 Corinthians, chapters 1 through 9, he doesn't send the letter yet. He waits. And I don't know why he waits, but there have been some troublemakers that doubt Paul and more accusations of false teachings toward Paul. And that prompted chapters 10 through 13, the rest of the letter. And then after he gets all that together, then he sends the letter to the people in Corinth. Those that are trying to follow the teachings of Paul in Corinth, they were easily persuaded to get off track. They were young Christians. They were just trying to figure out what the word Christ follower meant. And so the easiest way for people to get them off track was to say that their leader, Paul, was the one that they listened to, was spreading false teachings. It would kind of be like in our modern day, if you were a new believer and you followed Billy Graham and people were talking smack about Billy Graham. You would kind of question what is true and what isn't. So Paul was writing the letters so that he could strengthen the people in Corinth when he wasn't there, he'd already left. And in the letter, this part of scripture that we're talking about is where he had to justify what gives him the right to preach and teach.
Because back in that time, you had to kind of have credentials, so to speak, which was interesting because, of course, the actual teachers thought they were above, the Pharisees thought that they were above needing to put out any credentials, but they were telling Paul that he needed his credentials. So it put Paul in this difficult position where he didn't like to brag about himself, but he had to explain what had happened to him 14 years prior. So at this point in his letter, he's defending his preaching and teaching, and that's how we come to where God has spoken to him 14 years before. This is the first time that Paul speaks about what happened to him 14 years prior. He says that there was this man that was taken up into heaven 14 years ago, and this man in the vision is Paul. So Paul is talking about this man that had a vision, but it's actually Paul. This really happened to Paul, he says. Paul went to heaven, and he doesn't know if he was in his physical body or not. Only God knows that. And he's being very honest and vulnerable. There are pieces of his vision that he remembers very clearly and some pieces that he doesn't remember. But he knows that he was in heaven and he heard certain things. He heard things that no one was allowed to speak of. Paul was chosen to hear the words in heaven. This man, Paul, was different, seen different through God's eyes. Because through Paul's eyes, he sees himself as weak and a sinner. But through God's eyes, God sees him as one capable and chosen to spread the good news of Jesus Christ. God sees this man that can rise above and show the love and sacrifice of Christ where evil was trying to prevail, that evil would not prevail because of the stories that Paul could tell. Now, Paul knew the work of God, but he knew that it could only be completed, what God is asking of him could only be completed if God is working in him and through him. That would be the Holy Spirit working in him and through him. So Paul basically says, without God, without the Holy Spirit, I am weak and cannot do anything, but I'm happy to be weak because when I'm weak, I know that God is the strongest in me. That's probably why we had so many people flooding the churches after 9/11. Because people realize the vulnerability of humanity and the strength of God. Twice in verses 2 through 5, Paul uses the term, only God knows. There are so many things that happen in this world that only God knows why they happen. One of the examples, although there are many, I think Belinda gave us an example. Only God knows why your niece lived to be 23 to 25 years old when she was only projected to live until she was a year old. Only God knows. There are so many things that happen that we go, only God knows why this happened. And 9/11 is one of those. Nearly 3,000 people died on that day. 19 hijackers committed murder-suicide, and more than 6,000 people were injured. And of the almost 3,000, 2,753 were killed in the World Trade Center and the surrounding area. 184 were killed at the Pentagon, and 40 were killed in Pennsylvania. Think about all the families that were affected. I know the nation was affected, and think of the families as well. Only God knows why evil was allowed to attack that day. The free will of people is a powerful thing. That's why 9/11 happened, free will of people to make their own choice. And years after the fact, we see that God always gets the last word. We see how God's transformed the destruction into the faith in God. God speaks louder than the evil of 9/11. There's three stories I want to share with you. The first is from Christina Ray Stanton. She says, on the morning of September 11th, 2001, Christina could see the smoke billowing from the World Trade Center after the first plane hit. As she watched the black suit, The second plane flew within 500 feet of her 24th balcony. The sound of the roaring engine knocked her down and out and rendering her temporarily deaf. She and her husband, Brian, a finance executive, grabbed what they could, his wallet, the dog, and his leash. Christina was still in her nightgown with no shoes. And in a book Christina wrote 4 years ago, she describes how they joined the crowd of people in the streets running for their lives. As the towers fell and the yellow debris covered everything, Christina and Brian, exhausted, stopped. And she turned and she asked her husband, "Are we going to die?" He responded by saying the Lord's Prayer. In her book, she says that moment became the time when her faith was completely transformed. She said that when the attacks happened, I learned, wow, I actually have no control. She says she realized that life offered few guarantees, that it just wasn't work hard and God will bless and prosper you. My worldview was totally changed, she says. I really had to start over from the beginning. Who am I? Who am I in Christ? I would call myself somebody who went to church on Sundays, but I really had not internalized the Bible, internalized who Jesus was and who I am in him. And then another story from Jean and Dan Potter, who lived a few blocks from the World Trade Center in 2001. Jean worked on the 81st floor of the first tower that was hit in the attacks. Dan was a firefighter who, at that moment, was on Staten Island. When the first plane hit the tower where Jean worked, she said the building literally rocked from side to side. In the middle of the chaos of getting down all of the flights of stairs, she heard God several times comforting her with the understanding that it was not her time to die. When she was on the 20th floor, she saw a firefighter who had worked with her husband going up the stairs. Their eyes locked, and she grabbed his arm and told him to be safe. Lieutenant Vinnie Giamona never made it out and left behind a wife and four little girls just before Vinnie turned 40. He was one of the 343 New York firefighters who lost their lives that day. Dan Potter raced back from Staten Island, frantically looking and searching for his wife, and not finding her, he went back to their apartment, but he ended up eventually going to a bench before he gets to the apartment. He goes to a bench, and he's just sitting there on the bench that is covered with ash, and he ends up covered in ash, and there's a photographer that ends up taking his picture, and it becomes a very famous picture. And people have asked, what were you thinking at that time? He said, not finding her, I sat on the bench, and it was in that moment that I'm praying to Jesus, praying for clarity. What do you want me to do? What should I do? And then Dan believes that Jesus directed him to go back to their apartment, and it's there that the phone rings. His father, in tears, calls him and says, I'm wondering if you're okay, and I want you to know that Jean's okay. And he tells his son where to find his wife. In Jean's first book, By the Grace of God, a 9/11 survivor's story of love, hope, and healing, she says of God, he was with all of us that day. And I don't want people to think that they were so special because we were saved. I mean, it wasn't our time, and he was with those who were passing over, and it's just a great privilege to speak out about God. She goes on to say that both her and her husband hope and pray that the words that they read in her book and the book that she ends up writing a second one, that their story will also turn people to God and to trust in him. And then one more story. Stanley Pramnath, he was working on the South Tower. So Jean was on the North Tower, South Tower, also on the 81st floor. Shortly after 9 in the morning, he received several calls asking if he was okay after the attack on the North Tower had happened. And he assured people one after another that he was okay, and along with many others, he took the elevator down to the ground floor. The security officer down on the ground floor said, with all of the chaos and what has happened, you will be safer going back to your offices. So they get back in the elevator. They go back up to the 81st floor. He has on his desk a Bible that he has had there for years and years. And as he's talking to one more person on the phone who was asking if he was okay, he looks out the window and sees the plane coming right at him. The next minute, he is under that desk with the Bible on it. And after all of the crash happens, he looks up and he sees within feet from him part of the wing of the plane that has crashed into the building. And he wonders, he's crying out for help and nobody is answering him. And he wonders, why is it that people left me to die here? Didn't they care enough about me to help me out? And then when he looks around, he realizes they didn't leave him. They're dead. He was one of 18 in that second tower to live and make it down to the ground floor. On the way down, he's negotiating with God, like many of us do. God, if you just get me out of this, I'll do whatever it is you want me to do. And he went on to be a pastor. He kept his promise. God, if you get me out of this. He now is a pastor that travels from place to place telling his story and bringing God's word of hope and faith to those people. Through all of these experiences and so many more, I mean, there were a lot of stories, and you know that because you've probably read some of them as well. These people were molded and shaped by God into people of faith. Tragedy did not have the last word. People like you and I, all they did was listen to God and then agree to tell their story. It's similar for Paul. God equipped Paul, molding him, even with his past, even with everything he did before he was Paul. God equipped him to spread the gospel. Paul's vision of 14 years before helped to equip him for what he faced with his accusers when he's writing Corinthians, what he faces in any time in his life. Paul was strengthened by his visions to endure all things, and Paul would suffer often for his beliefs. Yet he could look back at the vision and gain strength from it. He could gain knowledge of a promise of the coming glory offered by faith in Christ. He could continue to gain strength going forward because of the memory of the vision, and he could tell his stories about Christ because of what had happened with him on the road to Damascus and a whole bunch of other places. God is bigger than the evil of this world. God speaks louder than Satan ever could. And God turns all things into glory, his good, his glory. Paul's life started out a life of hatred and persecution. Through the love of God, his life was transformed into being a missionary to spread God's love. We learn because of Paul's stories and because of many other stories in Scripture. We learn from our past tragedies as well, hoping that we don't repeat them. We should tell our stories not to brag, but we should tell our stories to glorify God. People don't want to hear our mistakes. People want to hear how we were transformed because of the power of God. Many of you have stories about how your faith has been built. Faith made stronger because of something that probably was uncomfortable to go through. Only God knows how difficult your life journey is. Only God knows how your difficulties will transform somebody else as well as you. God sees the entire picture of our lives. We just see a snapshot. We don't have any clue what's to come next. We don't know what's going to happen after we leave this building. Only God knows our whole entire story. There's so many people that can be reached by what we have to say. Just like the people that were struck in tragedy for 9/11 and they share their story of faith, we can share ours. Because people love stories. It's how we are drawn in to empathize with people. It's how we, sometimes if it's a funny story, how we're entertained. It's how we learn about people. And stories have other benefits. Language skills can be developed through stories. Okay, remember when I said that public speaking, people are really in fear of public speaking and would rather be in the casket than talking about the person that's in the casket. When we tell our story, it's kind of a form of public speaking, and maybe it will get us beyond that problem. Stories used to be the only way to share or transfer information from one generation to another. Knowledge or information was transferred, and they were used to pass on the wisdom of generations from one generation to the next. Which reminds me, I understand that we are remembering 9/11, but also, do you know what else today is? It's Grandparents' Day. Absolutely. Right. Grandparents' Day. This is a day of recognition that falls on the first Sunday after Labor Day. So it's a day to remember and recognize some amazing people. Ask a grandparent about a story of years past. Or if you're a grandparent, tell a story of years past. Because I bet you have many, and I bet if you ask your grandparents, there will be many stories. And they may even have a story about church. Okay, Shelley's going to play a little story about church.
Well, when I was a kid, I'd take a trip every summer down to Mississippi, visit my granny and her antebellum world. I'd run barefooted all day long, climbing trees, free as a song. One day, I happened to catch myself a squirrel. Well, I stuffed him down in an old shoebox and punched a couple holes in the top. When Sunday came, I snuck him into church. I was sitting way back in the very last pew, showing him to my good buddy Hugh. When that squirrel got loose, went totally berserk. What happened next is hard to tell. Some thought it was heaven, some thought it was hell. But the fact that something was among us was plain to see. As the choir sang, "I surrender all," the squirrel ran up Harv Newland's coveralls. And Harv leaped to his feet and said, "Something's got a hold on me, yeah!" The day the squirrel went berserk in the first self-righteous church, in a sleepy little town of Pascagoula. It was a fight for survival that broke out in revival. They were jumping pews and shouting hallelujah. Well, Harv hit the aisle dancing and screaming. Some thought he had religion, others thought he had a demon. And Harv thought he had a weed eater loose, and he's through the loom. He fell to his knees to plead and beg, and that squirrel ran out of his britches leg unobserved to the other side of the room. All the way down to the amen pew, where sat Sister Bertha, better than you, who'd been watching all the commotion with sadistic glee. Should have seen that look in her eyes when that squirrel jumped her garters and crossed her thighs. She jumped to her feet and said, "Lord, have mercy on me." As that squirrel made laps inside her dress, she began to cry and then to confess her sins and make a sailor blush with shame. She told of gossip and church dissension, but the thing that got the most attention was when she talked about her love life. And then she started naming names the day the squirrel went berserk in the first self-righteous church in that sleepy little town of Pascagoula. It was a fight for survival that broke out in revival. They were jumping pews and shouting hallelujah. Well,
7 deacons and the pastor got saved, and $25,000 was raised, and 50 volunteered for missions in the Congo on the spot. And even without an invitation, there were at least 500 rededications, and we all got rebaptized whether we needed it or not. Now you've heard the Bible story, I guess, how he parted the waters for Moses to pass. Oh, the miracles God has wrought in this old world. But the one I'll remember till my dying day is how he put that church back on the narrow way with a half-crazed Mississippi squirrel. The day the squirrel went berserk in the First Self-Righteous Church in that sleepy little town of Pascagoula. It was a fight for survival that broke out in revival. They were jumping pews and shouting hallelujah. The day the squirrel went berserk in the First Self-Righteous Church in that sleepy little town of Pascagoula. It was a fight for survival that broke out in revival. They were jumping pews and shouting
story, right? An entertaining story. We have entertaining stories that people want to hear. And it doesn't take a squirrel under, although that would be very entertaining. I promise I won't do it. Okay. What are some stories about the Bible? What? I got you. I didn't even have to go an extra 20 minutes. It was resolved right there, my brother. Love ya. We are even. Some stories. Hi, babies. Perfect timing. What are some stories that you remember from Sunday school? When you went to Sunday school? Or what is your favorite Bible study? Maybe you did not go to Sunday school. Maybe you came to Christ in adulthood, but you have a Bible study or a Bible story that is your favorite. Maybe it's, there you go. Maybe it is Moses and the burning bush. What did you guys talk about today? What did you talk about?
Yeah.
Yeah. Woohoo! Right? Stories. Perfect timing. Maybe the story is about John 3:16. Maybe Moses and the burning bush. Maybe Jonah and the whale or the big fish. Maybe Daniel and the lion or David and Goliath. What is your favorite Bible story? Because each of you either have one or should have one, because stories teach. Paul wrote about the pain in his body. And while he begged the Lord to take the pain away, he relays why God didn't. It is not clear what the pain was. It could have been a spiritual anxiety or emotional pain because people were doubting him, or a real physical pain within his body. But what the pain is or was is not as important as the answer that God gave. The answer that God gave Paul is the point of the story. From verse 9, he says, God says to Paul, "My grace is all you need. My power is strongest when you are weak." You hear the power in the story?
Yeah.
Yes. You got it, brother. You preach it. Biblical stories teach us who God is. We learn about God's love, his nature, his character by the biblical stories, and we also learn about his love, his character, and nature by the stories that we have in our lives, and then we can tell others. We tell stories to our children, our grandchildren, our great-grandchildren, because we want them to remember legacy long after we are gone. People write books and journals for their grandchildren so they know who their grandparents are. I have these pages and pages of journals from my grandfather, who was a sea captain on a square rigger, and I have pictures galore, but I have pages, stacks of pages and pages of journal, and they're written in Norwegian. Haven't found someone yet to translate them. If you know of someone, let me know. But there's story there. I know there's story there. Our district superintendent talks about a story from when the church in, from the fire, when the church in Greenville burned in Taylorsville. He and the bishop went after the Dixie fire, burned the church, and they are sorting through all of the remnants from the church, and he sees these concrete stairs going down below the ground floor, and he looks and he realizes that is a baptismal from years and years before that no one knew was there when the church, the foundation for the newer church was built. Think of the stories of that church for all those that were baptized from generation to generation. Paul had a lot of stories to tell. And after God gave him the vision of being in heaven, we continue to learn from Paul's stories, just like those that came before us and those that go after us. And let us add our own faith-filled stories to Paul's, our stories of how God has worked in our lives, building our faith and knowledge of who God is. Let us be storytellers. Let our testimony show others the hope that God offers. So this week, I want you to read your favorite Bible study again, or Bible story again, or find one if you don't have one, and then share it with one other person. And tell them why it's your favorite. Pray about that story in your life, the story of your testimony, and who God wants you to share it with. Pray about the timing of telling your story of hope, because the world needs to hear it now more than ever. Amen. Let us all stand for the final congregational hymn, Spirit Song.
Jesus, oh.
right, one more story of hope in the tragedy that happens sometimes. A sculpture made from keys of the homes built in the campfire. Would you join in watching this as our benediction?
This is for you.
I know that we're going to share a lot of things today, and one of those is going to be emotions. You have permission today to feel and experience however you need. I know that some of you, wherever you were, even back in November, the third day, when I was like, hey, wanna give me some keys?
Yep.
I can't believe that it reached 18,000 keys. Every piece of this has an intention, from the nails from the Honey Run Bridge to the keys from businesses, schools, safes, churches, jet skis, diaries. It was limitless, but the message I want to leave with before I introduce someone else is this. When I did this project, I picked up a key, and I didn't care what color you were, what age you were, your creed, your preference. I don't care, because we are all the same. We are beautiful people.
Rising from the ashes. It is what we do as Christ-filled, loving people. This week, let us rise and spread the love of God. Amen.